guys. How you doing today? Today, we're going to dig into a couple smaller labels. One of them is an important label that has a lot of very edgy, on the cusp of what was happening, jazz. And it was kind of designed to be that. We're talking, of course, about Candid. I'm not an expert on Candid. I have about a dozen titles. They created about 50 titles on this imprint from 1964 into probably mid-60s. A lot of great artists. A lot of it is edgier than the straight modern jazz. And like, for example, this record is as socially conscious as jazz really ever gets. Abby Lincoln and Max Roach here really, Coleman Hawkins is on this, by the way, which is pretty interesting. But it really is an edgy, forward-thinking, politically, socially charged session. We insist, you know, and good for them. It's about time. Candid was an affiliate of Cadence Records. And Cadence does more chamber music and some jazz, but I don't have a lot of Cadence stuff. The guy that that Green Book movie was based on, whose name I can't think of right now, was on Cadence, Don Shirley. But I don't have a lot of Cadence stuff for sure. The sequence runs 9,000 to about 9,053. And then Andy Williams, the pop singer, buys this label, which I can't give you any more information than that about that, but that seems so bizarre to me. But that's what my research has shown. And then it sells again in 1990 or so, and then there's a whole new sequence starting at 9,500, and that's going to be 90s era recordings of some great players that are still around and doing this thing in the 90s. But the main 50 records of Candid is what we're here to talk about right now. This, of course, is a legendary record. And during the civil rights era and the social movements of this time, this was a charged, dangerous record to make. Nat Hentoff, of course, was the guy in charge of the direction of this stuff. And he really wanted to be on the cutting edge and really wanted to have the music on this label to be expressive of what was happening now in jazz. That being said, I'm not a huge fan of some of it. There's a couple of Mingus records that are really out there, some really bizarre arrangements and live recordings that aren't the highest of quality, but there is also some stuff I do like a lot. This is We Insist record is super beautiful, and just the political message of it, it's something you have to stand behind. And of course, if you wake this out, there's places on here where Abby Lincoln, whose first record on Liberty, by the way, is her being kind of a soft crooner. Is that Booker Little on the trumpet? Looks like a Booker Little. Booker Little's such a beast. Only Freddie Hubbard and Clifford Brown could be doing that if it wasn't Booker Little. And Booker Little, of course, has a record here on Candid. Well, she'll start shrieking and exercising demons in a Coltrane-esque kind of way. So she comes from, like I said, her first record on Liberties, a pretty soft string poppy affair. But the record she does on Riverside, and then of course this one here on Candid, show a much darker side to Abby Lincoln, a much more aware side to Abby Lincoln. And what you can record on Riverside, Candid's going to give you a little bit more liberty than that. Liberty record's going to give you no liberty, ironically enough. Mingus, Reincarnation of a Lovebird, Stormy Weather, Lock 'Em Up. It's Charles really moves around a lot, label to label. I think a lot of that is going to be due to how difficult he was to work with. I think it wasn't just these musicians that he burned bridges with. I think even a lot of historians take issue with Mr. Mingus. He just has a bit of a chip on his shoulder, you know. I think he resents his black lot in life in this country, and I can't really fault him for that. But there's none of the forgiveness of Armstrong in Mingus. He's angry, he's resentful, he's militant, he's belligerent, he's armed with a pistol sometimes. All of this, though, is part of what geniuses often are. They're eccentric and unmanageable, and that unique take on this planet is part of what gives them that insight to see things from a different place and create something that's different. So Mingus is one of the true black sheep in jazz, in a way. Not really the word I'm looking for, but he's... I think he's. This was a real intense, burning guy, and he heard things his way, and there's times where, like, Pithecanthropus erectus to me is a brilliant statement that changes the landscape, and he continually kind of does that. But this is probably a live recording. I'm pretty sure it is, if I recall. It's not the best sounding stuff. But this is where Nat Hentoff was. Hentoff was willing to really document what was on the edge. He's a guy I love a lot. Whether it's his record on Bethlehem, the stuff with Max Roach, Booker Little, who's literally, we saw him on United Artists too just the other day. Booker Little is truly one of the great virtuosos on a trumpet. And there's a lot of great, great trumpet players. But for me, the ability to play at tempo, under control, just like athletics, your speed is only as good as your ability to play under control. Once you get out of control, you're a liability. And absolutely the same thing with front horn players. Just like Clifford and just like Freddie, he has a strong embouchure that enunciates cleanly. His rhythms are always on fire. We lost him very young, so we don't have a huge body of work on Booker Little. But Booker Little is one of the great virtuosos to play this music. And he's capable of doing things that very few trumpet players can do, has a great ear, and also loves the blues. And of course, that's always going to be underlying jazz on any level, is your understanding of the blues. And when we play the blues, how do you express? How do you emote? And Booker, for my money, is truly one of the secrets of jazz. This is Booker Irvin, and he has a record here early on, the Candid imprint. And Booker is definitely in the Coltrane school. A big, bright sound, plays with a lot of power and force, has a certain spirituality to him, a depth, an integrity, a soul-seeking, and I think that's all very attributable to Coltrane and one of his disciples. He's not a carbon copy by any means or a ripoff, but he's certainly in that school. And he has a couple of albums early on smaller labels, and then he goes to Prestige and makes a series of great records in the mid to late 60s. and then probably 68 or 9 he goes to Blue Note and makes a couple of really solid records there that come out after the sale to Liberty, and they're some of my favorite post-sale Blue Notes. The Space Book, the book series of stuff on his play on that word, on his name. Those are all great records on Prestige. But yeah, I dig Booker Irvin. This is fairly early in his trajectory, but you can already hear the type of expressive, fiery playing that he was going to be capable of in a moat for us. Next, I want to show you Abby Lincoln. And of course, we just talked about Abby on the Freedom Now record. And she's very aware. She's got a lot of blues and guts in her. She reminds me a little bit of Nina Simone, but an angrier, more resistant generation, and a gal that seems fed up and is willing to sacrifice to make changes. This is a tough record to find. It's worth seeking out. I remember when I found this in the wild, I was like, okay, I'm grabbing that. But she's definitely an important part of the tradition of vocal jazz and the freedom civil rights movement in jazz. This record has Max Roach, Coleman Hawkins, Eric Dolphy, Mal Waldron, Booker Little, Julian Priester, Art Davis, and Walter Benton. So it's a jazz record with a gal feeling her way through some sorrow, anger, and pain. And it's not a light affair where you're going to sit back and just be like, oh, we're Julie London, we're going to have a little tea and crumpets. This is music you play when you're packing bullets, when you're cleaning your weapons, sharpening your knives. You can play this record at that point. She's not to be tinkered with. She's quite the beast. And she probably had She probably had control of a lot of the situations she was in, romantically, socially. She doesn't sound like a weak, vulnerable woman in any way. This, of course, is the great Richard Williams. Nice little picture. Looks like it's probably Harlem. Certainly looks like New York with the steps and the whole ground floor apartments. Fiery trumpet player. Reminds me somewhat of Lee Morgan. I don't know a ton about this fella, but it's a cool Candid release, and I buy them when I see them. Steve Lacey's a pretty out there guy. He's not going to squeak and squeal, but he's certainly going to find you some edges and play in a very modern slices of avant way. He has a record on New Jazz, a record on Prestige, of course this record here on Candid. This is a cool record and I enjoy it. It's got a lot of pep to it. Again, he seems like a guy that's, I don't want to say bored with convention, but he's certainly willing to challenge the perimeters and the edges of the music. A record I found not too long ago, and this is a heck of a session. Pee Wee Russell, Coleman Hawkins. It's a reunion of a lot of great New Orleans jazz players. Bob Brookmeyer is also in the group. Joe Jones, and the four of them. I think there's a couple other members at times, if I recall. Yeah, it looks like there is. But they go through some really great swinging arrangements here. These guys, they're tackling some modern sounds, still with a traditional viewpoint. And it's really one of my favorite records on Candid because it's more in my vein of where I want to listen to more often. I'm not on the edge too often with what I want to hear. Life provides enough edge without me having to add. This, of course, is a nice little compilation on Candid, number 2019. And it's got a pretty who's who list of artists that appear on the Candid label. Now I want to switch gears to another small label out of New York. This was the Time label. And of all the labels I've done research on, this is one of the toughest records that labels to find much info on. I found a few paragraphs once. There was some New York impresario that starts this little label. History of the discography is very limited. But all the same, there's some really good titles here on the Time label. Time and Candid are the two smallest labels in terms of how many records I got that I'm going to cover. I still have about six other labels I'm going to get into yet, but I wanted to get these two out of the way. I have to have 10, 12 records by a label in order for me to file it by label, and these would be the two smallest in that category. Anything else under that number just goes into a miscellaneous section, which is probably yay wide, which is crazy if you think about it, because that wide section, there's no more than 10 titles from any label in there. So I mean, there's a lot of small, infinite labels in there that runs on and on and on, just label after label after label that had some stuff, but not huge volumes of known people. So anyway, Sonny Clark, love Sonny Clark. Of course, Blue Note, he has some of the best records there on Blue Note, late 50s. Max Roach and George Duvivier. This record has a couple different covers, if I recall, but it's a great trio setting. You really hear the stride and groove of Sonny, and stride and groove is pretty much half the battle. Another great player who ends up with two records here on Time is Kenny Dorham. We talked about Kenny Dorham some in the United Artists, and we also talked about him during the ABC episode, and of course Dorham's also on Blue Note and Riverside, but here he also shows up on the Time record label, and I think this one's an original pressing actually, this one's Japanese, but Showboat, Jerome Kern, and then Kenny Dorham, Jazz Contemporary. He makes two really solid records here on Time Records that are both worth seeking out. They used to be pretty affordable, but these are starting to climb up into the $40, $50 range now as well. There seems to be quite a theme with red and white and black on a lot of the Time album covers. It's Jimmy Heath on the sax right there, who of course just passed. But I adore him as a guy I love, and he's really one of the great trumpet players. Terry Gibbs, who has a lot of albums on Emercy Mercury, where he records and plays the vibe for a long time. He has a couple records on the Impulse label. I think he has a couple on Verve in the 60s. But this is probably 1960, 61 here. And he's playing a fairly fun, lighthearted affair here. But he's a great vibraphone player and a guy worth digging out. Another record that the Time label, one of the things that brought me to Time Records was this Benny Green record. And of course, Benny Green plays on Blue Note, makes a number of really good records there. And I've been pretty much anyone that was on Blue Note. I was gonna buy their records when I came across them. And I saw this Benny Green record numerous times before I finally grabbed it. Because I'm like, I thought it was some kind of budget label or some late reissue package. But then I finally realized this was a contemporary recording from the 60s on a little label I just didn't know nothing about. And again, there's the same kind of red, white, black, a little green on that one. But Benny's a great player. Probably a notch below Curtis Fuller in terms of his ability to play at tempo. Fuller's really great playing the hard bop, bebop stuff, and I think Green has a little more blues to him, a little bit more soul jazz to him, but he's still an absolutely wonderful player. Mm-hmm. another guy we just talked about, who again has another record here, Booker Little. So we're seeing a lot of Booker Little's records with these little labels that we're covering right now. This guy would have had a great career. You know, early Candid, early Bethlehem, early United Artists. Here he is on the Time label. I think that's his four records as a leader. And he does a number of records with Max Roach, replacing Clifford Brown, of course. And then, sadly, he dies real young. And we lose another one of the great potential futures of this music. And we did lose so many of the greats in this era at such a young age that in a lot of ways the future of jazz gets extinguished a little bit with each one of their passings. You know, that's the legacy. That's the sad part, is that when guys pass away, we're not just losing a great player, we're losing a potential future in jazz. Carmen McRae?
In San Francisco.
Carmen McRae, of course, is a lovely bluesy singer. She's capable of doing fairly great up-tempo stuff, but I've always loved to run ballads. So you're seeing Time also has a lot of cool artists, great titles. Again, kind of a reddish cover there. Marion McPartland, a UK piano virtuoso. She has records at Savoy in the early 50s. Some of them come on 10-inch. Some of them are reissued on the LP in the 12,000 series. She also has a record at Argo. Capitol, I think she has a couple of records. Mary McPartland makes records for a long time. And she's not someone you need to have every record she ever did. But you should have one Mary McPartland record because she's a great player. And she's one of the powerful women in jazz. And then, of course, the other artist that really was of note is Max Roach. And Max Roach has two records here on the Time imprint, just like Kenny Dorham did. So you're seeing there's some pretty heavy hitters here on the Time label. When you have Booker Little, Max Roach, Kenny Dorham, Benny Green, these are quality names. And I've seen a few other Time titles over the years that I've passed up, but I'm pretty much at the point now where I see when I just grab it. I have about a dozen Candid and about a dozen Time records. And so like I said, like they're at the bottom of, that's the fewest number of a label's records I have in order to file them by label. And I still got three West Coast labels we're going to dig into, Fantasy Contemporary and Pacific. I still want to cover CTI, which I have a lot of stuff by, and it's the end of the Creed Taylor story. And then we have a number of subsidiary labels which I want to get into. Prestige has the New Jazz print, which we got to do an episode on. Riverside has the Jazzland series, which I'm going to do an episode on. And then Savoy had the Regent sub-label, which has some interesting titles on it. So we still got a number of labels to cover here, so by no means is this a wrapping it up. But I still want to get these two ones done here. I appreciate y'all for watching. Stay tuned to my channel. A lot of great stuff to come. Please subscribe. Be safe out there, guys. Peace. Bob McAdoo, Buffalo Braves.